one of those, like floppy wall, mitral wall disease, ankylosing spondylitis, rheumatoid arthritis. These are something eye catchers, you know, ki everyone knows. HLA-B 27 hai kya? Ki this is a general, you know, ki even physician, surgeon, anyone is knowing about it. People may not know some difficult keratitis from ophthalmic region or some difficult for disease in spine or Forrester's disease dish, but everyone knows about Angspond because this disease, when it grows, it becomes very dreadful. It becomes very tough and very challenging. When you see some people on the road, when you are small, you laugh at it, why he's like that. But when you become little mature, you understand this is an unfortunate curse of God to mankind and how can we treat. And here, the heroes of medicine comes. And who are the heroes? The real heroes for treating Angspond are all my fellow physicians and the rheumatologists. They are the true heroes treating this disease now and for always. You know, they keep seeing this patient for donkey's years. The patient comes, sometimes they are with pain, they are not with pain. And that's how the practice goes on. And when this patient keep coming, they come for 1 year, they come for 4 years, they come for 10 years, they come for 20 years and unending. This is where the ankylosing spondylitis is. And why I'm calling them heroes? Because rheumatologist is a person who tries to treat or control this disease with medical management, with rehabilitation, with physiotherapy. Tell me if I'm wrong. And as a surgeon, our role is very limited in this disease. Our role is mainly surgical for treating this when there is a complex deformity. We do see a lot of patients because this disease presents as back pain to begin with everywhere. And when it is back pain, nowadays the spine surgery is going at a different level. People understand, I have back pain, I need to go to a spine specialist, and they come to us. That's how this disease is becoming more understandable nowadays. That's what I personally feel. When we understand that it is a back pain, we do see a lot of Angspond. We do see a lot of rheumatoid back pains, psoriatic back pains in our practice. But when after some time, when we realize that this patient is needing some kind of medications, this is becoming a little bad, then we understand that we have limited role, because now with a lot of immunomodulators and biologics coming in, which this rheumatology, therefore we call them a hero for this disease, because they are the ones who can at least try to control this disease to maximum extent. And who wants surgery? Nobody wants surgery in this kind of difficult diseases. And Angspond, whenever we say Angspond, as an undergraduate, we always compare it with HLA-B27. What is HLA-B27? It's a gene. How many people are positive with this? Not all the patients with HLA-B27 have ankylosing spondylitis. Only 1 or 2% will go to that extent. Therefore, a lot of patients you see and they have HLA-B27, don't just think, he's gone, and things are bad. It's not like that. Very few of them will progress. Tell me, Ajit, what I'm saying is right or no?
Yes.
Yeah, so that one thing, myth has to go from everyone's mind. HLA-B27 is a gene and it's possibly 90% of them will have. Only 2% will have the disease, ankylosing spondylitis, where we see common affections in this disease are sacroiliac joint. We see fusion of the spinal bones, what normally is very classically called as, like in spine, the few famous ones like bamboo spine, which is very, very famous. And we always see bamboo spine. We see the neck, which is crouch, and the flexion attitude in the neck. These are the 2-3 important characters. At the same time, if you see young boy versus girl, so 2-3 times more than girls in young boys, 15, 20, 25 years, you see this with a very thin body shape, contour, and difficult in breathing also, because they can't. There is a fusion of the costo-transverse junction, even costochondral junctions, all these things start fusing, and that's where we have to understand this is something which is not routine. When you can't breathe, just imagine, we talk about yoga, we talk about so many things. If you are taking deep breath and someone has not been able to do that, this is where we have to think more soft towards this disease to treat it better. Let's start with the case scenario. 23-year-old man comes with back pain radiating to both buttocks for 3 months and severe in the morning, characteristic. gets better as the day passes, gets better when he takes shower with hot water. The diagnosis is very, very close. When we see the x-ray, we realize there is something happening and we realize that the SI joint is getting affected. SI joint, normally we see upper third, mid third and lower third. The lower third has the maximum potential of some kind of motion occurring and inflammation. That is where we start getting this kind of picture. And on examination, when we see the patient clinically, two, three important tests, you know, in Angspond, we all know as graduate, postgraduates, the Faber, the Patrick Faber's test, flexion, extension, abduction, external rotation. So in this, we always see there is some kind of positivity in Faber's test, Ganselin, we always extend the hip and we see there is pain at SI joint. We see the compression distraction test of SI joint. We see the Schober's test, checking how much you can bend forward or no. And these three, four things are important when we examine Angspond. At the same time, we have to check the chest exertion. You know, we say, okay, how much the chest can expand. And if it is less than 3 centimeters, we need to rule out other things. In some instances, when the pain is quite significant, unilateral SI joint, then we need to rule out because sometimes we may miss some kind of infection and it's important that we should not miss. MRI is a gold standard nowadays, becoming gold standard as the PET scan has comparatively a limited role. MRI really can delineate between infective versus inflammatory. At the same time, we should do blood markers also. And where we see the inflammation of the vertebral body, the shiny corner sign and hyperintensities in facet, costovertebral junctions. And my role here, my role is just, as I told, refer to a rheumatologist friend when the patient is showing all these signs and it is Ajit Nalavade who is the boss for us. Then it comes Nilesh Patil and then Dr. Gayatri. We always send this patient when we realize we have limited role in this. My role as spine surgeon, what is my role as spine surgeon? At the time of initial diagnosis, at the time of understanding the spinal instability and in late scenarios presenting with a deformity. So my role is in mainly three things. One is that we need to understand if whether there is a fracture, because when we see a bamboo spine, a patient comes and a history of fall, we should suspect if there is a terrible pain, a severe exacerbation of pain, it's not getting better, even a small micro fracture, because it breaks like chalk stick. This is very characteristic. It's called as chalk stick fracture. You know, okay, what we have the chalk stick in this, when we were in school, the chalk we use, and it's because it's like a column. It's not a normal fracture. It's a column fracture, shear fracture. And this is what we need to understand. Second, we have to understand about whether there's any discitis or Anderson's lesion, and whether it's a late presentation with significant deformation. And this is where my main role as a surgeon, otherwise I'm a spine specialist, where I'm also treating back pains with Angspond or rheumatoid arthritis. But when this deformation or instability is significant, then my role comes as a spine surgeon. And in the initial diagnosis, we normally, when the patient keeps coming to us, when we diagnose with basic HLA-B27 is positive, and sometimes we do see some kind of a mixed picture where it is SNSAs, what we say, HLA-B27 may be negative, but we have the clinical picture, which is very, very close. Sometimes clinically, the DISH, what we call diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis, can mimic or imitate like a Angspond, but characteristic is X-ray. The minute you see the X-rays, you have to understand this is DISH, this is HLA-B27. We will have the discussion with all the dear friends, Dr. Nilesh, who is moderating the session today. We will enlighten on this topic as well. And role of orthopedic rheumatologist, basically in therapy of rheumatic disease, this article which was published. And a lot of stress in early diagnosis. More often, orthopedic spine surgeons are first contact, but change the era. This is change after what rheumatologist talks about the biologics. And I think it's going to be a wonderful journey now onwards. It's going to change the world in next 10 to 15 years. I'm sure these medicines will work so well in the early phases where they will control the maximum disease. That's what we feel and we hope in this particular disease. First description was in the 1600s, you know, Bernard Connor described this as SPA, what we always talk about, spondyloarthropathy. Spondyla is vertebranitis, is inflammation. And the family, various arthritis, whatever comes in common, we see reactive, psoriatic, IBD associated, juvenile and undifferentiated. And what's common, that's again, rheumatoid factor is absent in seronegative. Frequently, we see HLA-B27. Common association, again, we see oligoarthritis, enthesitis, costochondritis, extra-articular features also, uveitis, genitourinary and skin. And it is a complete circle of inflammation and arthropathy. I will not go into a lot of theoretical details here because it's unending then, you know, that's what I feel. And actual component, we need to understand early versus late, undifferentiated SPA and the Angspond late. Is the burden is same? Again, it's determined by the severity of symptoms, seriousness of global pain and night pain. This is the article by Medina. And this is the characteristic and burden of disease in patient with radiographic and non-radiographic axial spondyloarthropathy. This was a comparative study and where they realized that the patient global assessment, severity of symptoms, all this will determine the burden of the disease. And patient with both RAX SPA and NRAX SPA should be treated with equal priority and distinction between both should only have implications for clinical research, but not clinical practice. That's the very, very important statement from this article, which they have. And this is where the game changer, the Eugen Brown's article, and where we can see the biologics playing the role, immunohistological changes. And this is where we have come. And SI joint, we conclude under CT guidance. These are all the golden papers, which I'm quoting here. And which are showing the importance of biologics. And early diagnosis, how early should ankylosing spondylitis should be treated with TNF blockers and baseline predictors of response to TNF alpha? All these are going to be the game changers in rheumatic practice for ankylosing spondylitis. And we all know basic investigations, the rheumatologists, or we also can start with basic CBC, ESR, CRPs are raised, HLA-B27 is 90% positive. No single test is diagnostic, but X-rays are paramount, X-rays are important. You do see serum IgA levels are increased, elevated alkaline phosphatase in severe disease, and remaining can be absent, the rheumatoid factor, CCP and ANAs. Risk factor and prognosis, progression. Again, there are various factors. I will not go into much details because we will come to the mainly the surgical part and few of the things which we thought of covering up is very, very important. When the patient comes to us, we always talk about the rehab and physiotherapy. People ask various questions. They ask about how important is swimming and how important is deep breathing, how important is stretching, all these things. Can I play? Can I do run? All these things. I think it is very, very important that overall patient as a, you know, you have to consider the patient as your own family member. You know, always you realize the difference between when you treat your family member and you treat a patient. You are always more soft to your family member. And the same thing, if you consider for Angspond patient, things will become more better if you spend more 5-10 minutes for explanation of stretching and doing all the activities, swimming, all these things really help breathing, because the more you do, the more you are going to be more better, and it will prevent the progression. Anti-inflammatories are required for those who are with a lot of pain, and we will discuss the biologics with our all colleagues. We will not go into the detail of this exercise because it is definitely very, very important. And NSAIDs, definitely TNF inhibitors. All this is where we really try to do. And this is for mainly 95% of the patient, or I will rather say 96 to 97% of the patients will need whatever I was talking till now. And now the remaining 3% or 4% where there is acute exacerbation, patients are not getting better. You ruled out it is not infection. SI joint affected, bad pain, not getting better. And this is where we can consider giving injection, the pain block, SI joint pain block under image intensifier we normally prefer. And we always have a dialogue with the rheumatologist in this particular aspect. We can repeat this pain block 2 or 3 times in very few patients, but normally our experience with giving this maybe twice a year, you know, that's what is our experience. And sometimes we do see patient who comes with back pain and just had a fall, never done an X-ray in life. And if you see these three column injury, we have to be very careful. And this patient was referred by one of the orthopedic surgeons to us, and they were a little confused. And the minute I saw it, I said, this is a complete three column injury. We did his MRIs and we will show you his story. And spinal trauma, because this is a chalk stick fracture, it's very, very important. They are completely unstable fracture. They are mostly tricolumnar, and they will come with neurological deficit. It can be very, very acute. And we have to understand, even cervical spine, we do get a lot of patients like that, and they break like anything. Therefore, patients, you have to tell, you have to take care. If you are 60, 70, and you are having some difficulty in walking, you always recommend patient walk, use a walking stick. The minute you fall, you have a surgery. There is no option. It's as good as that. Therefore, you have to be very careful in Angspond, because bones are brittle. Porosis plus Angspond and age, it's not a good combination. If you want to avoid, additional stick will not be of, it is just safety for you. And this is where we do see this kind. And this is a patient, he comes with trivial trauma, bordering, severe pain, couldn't sleep at night. And when we did his X-rays and MR, it showed all this three column injury. And when the patient is with Angspond, we do see we have to take the anesthetic in consideration, because cervical spine, sometimes it can be a difficulty, and we have to consider the option of nasogastric intubation in this patient, because routine tube, because they may not have a proper opening, because jaw can have Angspond jaw and they will not be able to open. The mouth opening will be small. They will be having difficulty. Epiglottis will not get reduced when you are putting the tube. All these things are very, very important. Therefore, anesthetic has to see the patient when there is something like this, respiratory consideration. You have to see whether the patient is having restrictive lung disease. If need be, you can do the PFT as well. You have to understand. If you do the PFTs and you understand the values better, because in this inspiratory phase, you can inspire, but expiration will be low. This is where, because they can't do that, and this is where there'll be a less compliance of the lung. So we have to check the vital capacity, the lobe fibrosis. All these are the important considerations when the patient of Angspond comes to you, because it may be going on for a long time. TMJ ankylosing, again, it limits the motion. We all know we have to check it. Clinical examination is important. How much is the jaw opening? We have to see with the fingers how many fingers he can open. And then again, nasogastric, as I was talking, fiber optic nasal intubation should be considered. Cardiacs, they can have cardiac anomalies. Always we screen with the cardiologist or the 2D echo. We always check whether there is any other problem with them. And the clinical evaluation, all these things become mandatory. If the patient is on some biologic or any other, we always ask our rheumatology colleague to have a look on these kind of patients before they are taken to the surgical theater. As I was mentioning, all these things were very, very important, and awake fiber optic intubation is the choice. And at times we see that patient with significant neck flexion, attitude, gazing issues will be seen. And this is what we had to fix this patient. We fixed it, and this patient is doing fine. And luckily, there is spontaneous autofusion in most of the Angspond. And at 3 to 6 months, you'll see it's completely filled up with a lot of bone stock. And you don't have to worry. And you have to treat the osteoporosis. And that's how it is. Thoracolumbar is very, very commonly seen. And at times, if you're really lucky, you can get away with bracing. But most of the fractures are quite nasty, and we have quite high grade. We have to consider even cervical. We have operated quite a lot of cervical spine injuries, fascial dislocation, because it's like a crankshaft. It breaks like a chalk, and that's where it is. And when we are considering the surgery, we have to consider a long segment fixation. The shorter segment may not take the hold or the burden of the spine, and we have to consider 3 to 4 level, minimum 2 to 3 level spine fixation in these kind of fractures. In severe deformations, we have to consider deformity correction, and there are various patients who come for deformity correction. Recently, we had a patient who was who married with his married for 7-8 years, and his wife never saw him straight. He is a software guy, and he's doing all the work while sitting because he's got getting better posture. But the minute he stands, he's got an upward gaze, and he's not been able to see in front. That's a big problem. And his wife, and these are the cases where there is a significant neck angle which we have to correct, and we do deformity correction in this. Various osteotomies are described for this, where we do PSO, the pedicle subtraction osteotomy, or we do vertebral column resection and correction for these kind of fractures. Non-displaced fracture can be missed easily because of the x-rays. Therefore, computerized tomographies are important. And this is one important thing I would like to tell to all my colleagues, that don't miss. If you don't see anything and the patient is in pain, always go for a better or higher investigation. In doubt, always do MRI, because it will pick up the early marrow signal change, and it will tell us there is a fresh fracture, and x-ray may or may not show some translation. This is where the MRI comes. Maybe it is 5,000 rupees, 4,000 rupees additional for the patient to just screen the spine or do the dedicated study, but it's always useful. And for patient with angspond, it's always, we have to consider front and back, or surgery where it we have to assess whether it is cervical thoracic or thoracolumbar deformity, and various different surgeries we do for this. And these are the ones where we have corrected. Most of them are mainly thoracolumbar, where we correct angle, and they are straight. At least their expectation is, I am fixed, but I would like to see the world. I want to feel the world, because they can't see. The gaze is a problem. Even ophthalmic problems are going to happen. And this is where I'm not going into the detail of surgery, because that's not relevant or right when I'm talking for a rheumat TV. But this is what is our experience. I'm just sharing. We do see Anderson's lesion, and this was something which was described by Anderson in 1937. It results from the inflammation or stress fracture of the complete or enclosed spine, and there is no evidence of infection, but this what we normally call the, in the past they used to call aseptic discitis, but that's no more a true term nowadays. We call a rheumatic discitis, maybe, right? And where there is this kind of a pseudo lesion, and the maybe there is a non-union at the same time. And this is the lesion which can contribute to significant pain. We need to understand whether it is stable or unstable. 63 man, back pain, history of trauma, a lot of morbidities, fall from bike. And this is the case which we are showing. And there was a fracture with a significant deformation. There is a translation, lateral listhesis, extremity also were weak. Lower extremity, there was some typing error, but and this is what the patient comes with. The chin brow angle was significantly increased. Gaze the vertical angle was 30. Occipital wall distance, this is always important. Whenever we see the occipital wall distance, we check, and this is the distance what we talk about. And we were 55, and this is where we see morbidly obese man with the fracture and with significant deformity. This is like a O deformity, we can say, and it's a nightmare to treat such cases. And if you don't treat it at right time, there can be a significant neurological deterioration. And we see this is how the, this is not, this is a completely unstable spine. We have to consider a long fixation for this, and we have to have proper anesthetic backup, proper foldable theater tables, and that's also important. Nowadays we have the O-arm navigation with us, and we can be more accurate and precise to operate these cases. But we have done this surgery for many years now with freehand technique. Once you, because the anatomy can be disturbed, we have to give more time. We have to spend complete maximum time for this patient. And if you have additional hand to help you as an expert hand, that's always encouraged for this kind of, because there sometimes there can be brittle bone, sometimes there can be sclerotic bone. It takes longer time. Sometimes there can be more bleeding. We have to be careful when we really plan this case, and this kind of significant deformities we have to fix along basically. And this is what the on table, the fiber optic, the angle, the table we have to break, we have to put it on, and this is a challenge. And if you see where the patient's hand is resting, we adjusted the complete level, and this is where we had to keep it in flexion and constant monitoring. Even sometimes we ask our anesthetic team to keep two anesthetists, you know, because someone can miss something, though it has to be always monitored, you know, and because it runs for a longer time, though it's always beneficial if there is additional hand to them also, because sometimes it can take 6 to 8 hours, 10 hours as well. And this is where we have fixed. If you are lucky, you can really get away faster. And we did a kind of a PSO, the pedicle subtraction osteotomy. And again, there was some fall, and this patient comes back to us, and we fixed the patient at, because he had the fracture at the level which was completely where we completed the fixation. Below that, there is a fracture at 21st day, and this is where we fixed, and now he's doing fine. And this is where we have to understand the flexion deformity of the cervical spine, thoracolumbar kyphosis, and fixed flexion deformity at the hip. Sometimes we do see patients, not sometimes, many a times in full-blown angspond, we have the hip fused at the same time the spine, and we have to take a consult of the hip surgeon as well in this. And these are the different osteotomies. I will not go into the detail. We have to understand the positive sagittal balance in management of these kind of severe deformities. And we have various softwares nowadays to plan the deformity correction, and we use them when we plan these kind of deformities. And I will not just go quickly now with a few cases which were done with us. And this is the guy with cervicothoracic deformity. If you see the sagittal profile, all this, I will not talk much because we are running short of time. We have to do a complete job of deformity correction. And this is the spinal cord. We go anterior. We do a vertebral column resection, partial or full. And this is the fixation and the post-op. And you see the patient is standing straight. The sagittal parameters are improved. And this is where it's of significant use to the patient long-term. Normally, we don't get much of patients with proximal junctional issues where we stop our fixations if you're fixing into the dorsal spine. But still, we have to tell the patient there can be a possibility of proximal junctional issues where we stop our fixation. Longer fixations are always recommended, and these are how the cases are. And we fix and we try to give justice to them as much as possible. Sometimes it becomes difficult for us to correct completely because overstretching, we use neuromonitoring for all this. And this is how it is. And nowadays we don't want to talk about, but we have to be careful because a lot of good medicines have come. Mortality, which used to be in the past important factor, but now this is a 1981 paper, but nowadays it's a significantly better outcome disease than what it used to be. And I think with a good medical backup, we really are happy to treat such patients surgically as well. Thank you very much for patient hearing. Thank you for giving me time. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session today. And so it was a major learning for all of us. So I would like to ask a few questions first. So like you said, many of the patients, they come with the complications like severe hip osteoarthritis and spine issues like Anderson lesions. So if needed, which you operate first, hip or spine?
Because no, I think, it's a catch 22.
Yes.
But we always see how bad the hips are affected. Sometimes I feel if you do the hip surgery, because when the hips are affected, they really hardly can walk.
Yes.
With spine, even if it is crouched, they can still manage to walk. If both the hips are affected, I probably will consider a bilateral hip replacement where they are mobile and they are doing basic things. And at that time, we can take a call whether they really need that or they're managing with that anchoring of the hip. Then ball and socket is working well. They're walking, doing everything, market. They're happy. The pain is gone. And if they really want, we really can make them absolutely straighter. They and those who are very positive patients, we definitely can consider a spine if it is as bad as how it was before.
Yes, it was really a wonderful session. Like I said, if we are the heroes who treat these patients, you are the superheroes who get patient into the life with playing such a delicate bone. Yes. And then I have one more question. How is the outcome with the cervical surgeries, cervical spine surgeries?
No, I think now we have a lot of patients where we have operated now. Recently, in near our hospital, there is a very big bank and the general manager had a car accident. This is 10 years back and he was transported to us that time. He had a C4-5, 5-6 fracture dislocation and bordering neurology that time. We had operated. Now he's almost 10-year follow-up. He's doing absolutely fine, everything. And he keeps sending patients from his bank. He keeps telling everyone, this is my surgery done by this doctor at this hospital. And they're very happy. So I think once it is surgery is done carefully, I think the answer is a very good outcome because it fuses. You know, Kang's bond throws bone. It's spontaneous fusion. It's like normal, you know, as good as normal. So if the primary surgery is done well, I think there is a good outcome long term. And if you are with deficit, that's not in our hand how much they really can recover. But if they are not with the deficit immediately done, I think there is a good answer.
I have a few questions for panel as well. So first, I would like to ask Ajit Nalavade, sir. So how is it difficult to monitor these patients, whether the pains are because of the disease activity or they are because of the mechanical issues? So how difficult it is and how do you treat these patients?
Yeah, clinically in the patient with very long standing ankylosing spondylitis, this can pose a real problem. In fact, whenever patient comes with worsened back pain, it really is important to take a detailed history. What I tend to ask these patients is the quality of this pain similar as to what it used to be in the initial parts of the initial time of the disease? Or is it something different which you have never experienced? This is one of the important things because what we are here trying to differentiate here is the mechanical causes of back pain, especially the Anderson lesions or any new fracture that has happened. And of course, whether it is associated with early morning stiffness, raised inflammatory markers, those will definitely help to identify whether it is because of flare of the disease. And usually the pain because of flare of disease will not be very localized, and which can happen with the mechanical problems that that have occurred. So that is another differentiating point. So history taking is very important for such patients, but we definitely should consider alternative possibilities for a patient presenting with back pain.
So I'd like to ask Dr. Gayatri. So here we always see delicate bones in ankylosing spondylitis, but at the same time, if we try to get their BMD scans, the T-score and Z-score, they're always falsely elevated. So what is your, can you please elaborate? So why there is a discrepancy?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Shailesh sir, first of all, for such a wonderful talk. Sir, yes, it's a paradox because there is a formation of syndesmophytes, which are the bridging bones, or this is because of the inflammation. There is a formation of syndesmophytes. At the same time, there are many mechanisms due to which the bones are quite brittle. Like you have TNF-alpha, which is a catabolic cytokine. It decreases, down-regulates the anabolism. Then it decreases the resting energy expenditure. Then you have certain cytokines like IL-17, IL-23, which are responsible for bone marrow edema, inflammation, enthesitis, and overall bone loss. Then there is a subclinical colitis in ankylosing spondylitis, and sometimes when patients have ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease, so they have vitamin D deficiency and calcium malabsorption also. So all these factors together lead to a state of brittle bone, But because of the syndesmophyte formation in Angspond, you get the false DEXA scan, which is more than 2.5. And that's the reason, even though we have a state of osteopenia or osteoporosis, the BMD could be falsely elevated. Mm-hmm. But we have to be very careful because these are susceptible for fragility fractures, especially at the spine and neck of the femur.
Yes. And thank you. And I would like to ask Dr. Divakar, so can you please tell us different Anderson lesions and how do we differentiate which Anderson lesion to be treated surgically and which to be treated conservatively?
The lesions which are totally painful and making patient disabled,
yes,
and which are unstable, yes, I think they should be managed surgically, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Yes.
How do we go about with a patient who has only sacroiliitis and nothing else? And HLA-B27 negative.
Okay.
Nalavadi, sir.
Okay, I'll take up the question. So, the patient, you mean to say, has presented only with inflammatory buttock pain in one of the sites and evaluation only has sacroiliitis unilateral. That is what your question is. So how do we proceed?
Yes.
Now, to cut the long story short, there are just three causes which can cause unilateral sacroiliitis, which are of concern. One is whether it is infective or bacterial sacroiliitis. Second is tubercular sacroiliitis. And more commonly, it is undifferentiated spondyloarthritis. See, the infective sacroiliitis will occur in patients who are susceptible to infections, especially bacterial sacroiliitis won't happen in any normal young patient. So usually immunosuppressed patients on immunosuppressants or diabetes or comorbidities, in such cases, you definitely suspect infective sacroiliitis. But patients will typically have toxic symptoms, systemic symptoms, but 50% of patients with bacterial sacroiliitis can present without these symptoms. So we really have to consider this as a differential diagnosis, especially in elderly. But if the patient is young, less than 45 years of age, and has no comorbid conditions, has no risk factors for infection, definitely it is more likely to be spondyloarthritis. And these patients will respond to anti-inflammatory drugs. The other patients basically who might have infective sacroiliitis won't respond to simple anti-inflammatory drugs. And MRI will be very helpful. The anatomical boundaries are, not tampered with in inflammatory sacroiliitis. But infections won't respect anatomical boundaries and you'll have inflammation outside the anatomical boundaries. So that is how you can definitely identify patients with inflammatory sacroiliitis, that is undifferentiated spondyloarthritis.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. My turn for a question.
Yes.
Velish.
Yes.
Very, very nice presentation. Now, what I wanted to ask is, what, according to you, would be the, timing or exact indication and precise timing to intervene in Anderson lesion? Okay, you have diagnosed Anderson lesion. We are basically conservative or surgical. Divakar has already told us something, but is the timing important? If delayed, the outcomes are bad, something like that. And all those surgeries which you have performed, what is the incidence of neurological complications you have encountered?
Yeah, I think that's a very good, important question. And we always talk about Anderson lesion And a lot of time patient do come to us at a very late stage or is worsening with neurology. And a lot of time we do see patients, whether type 1, type 2 and type 3. Cowley and colleagues have described the Anderson's and you know the disco vertebral lesions into these three types. When we talk about this type 1 involves the central portion of the disco vertebral junction that is covered by the cartilage. The type 2 lesion involves the peripheral portion of disco vertebral junction not covered by cartilage end plate, and type 3 involves both peripheral and central portions. When it is type 3, normally it's reasonably unstable, but I will say when that instability, clinical and radiological instability, pain, translation or patient is with deformity, with impending neurological deficit are the ones who need surgery. A lot of times there can be a non-union and patients are managing without any neurological deficit and it is ongoing for a long time. Probably they don't need surgery. We need to take a detailed history in this, and that's important that sometimes patients unnecessary we should not subject because it's radiologically seen. Anterior and posteriorly it is fused, but in you are seeing that Anderson's lesion. So that's not something which we should rush for surgery, but we have to see whether it's really unstable. So these are the important things we should do, investigate them thorough. That's one, and plan. If the patient will complain, if the pain is not settling with medicines and things, patients will complain. And this is where we need to consider for fusion of that particular segment. What are the second question, Ajit?
The neurological complications, percentage of patients who might develop after operating in such patients.
Yeah, it's a very, very important thing for us because they are not like normal patients. Normal patients where every level is mobile or at least lumbar spine, cervical spine, every level is a single level. In Angspon, it's like a complete column. And when the column is broken, like this is the column and it one side is broken, this is dipped in. So what's happening? The cord is going along with it. We are doing some maneuvering. We are putting the screws into this column. This is completely moving because this is, you know, here. This is how the chalk stick is broken, right? Normally in these fractures, it's like just subluxating or something like that. We have this. But in Angspon, in cervical, we do see suddenly this complete translating injuries. And there is a lot of people come with the neurological deficit, thoracolumbar spine especially, in cervical spine. But earliest possible intervention, whenever they come, if they come within 24 hours or maybe 12 to 24 hours, the outcomes are really better. Whatever the injury, unless it's a really significant injury, because whatever is always inversely proportional to the impact of the trauma on the cord. It's not a disease. The cord injury will dictate the future prognosis. Surgical insult, I will say, is comparatively less because we use neuromonitoring these days. Neuromonitoring tells us if the patient is nil neuro, it's dreadful-looking deformity or dreadful-looking fracture. But still, when we are using neuromonitoring, we can undo at times when we are doing. When we were not using the neuromonitoring, we were a little scared. Sometimes patient can have a neurological insult after the surgery. We are lucky we have not had such major insult, but we have heard of things happening, and no one is wrong in this because the disease and the morphology is such bad, it can happen. You know, patient can worsen after surgery.
Thank you.
And so you generally do these kyphosis correction surgeries very often in these patients.
Yes.
So when do you refrain from doing these surgeries?
No, I think sometimes we have to understand with the patient, how much the patient is motivated, how much he understands, how much this deformity will... I will tell you an example of a patient and he was a 54-year-old. I have so many cases, you know, but because of time, I didn't show it. So he had significant global kyphosis. I still have the case with me. Global kyphosis. He's a 55-year, a very healthy farmer. Very good farming. His children are doing fine. They have a lot of land with sugarcane built. And he had 20-year problem of digestion. 20-year. And he was with Angspon. Yes. And some vaidya or some doctor in his area told him that time, boss, if someone will correct your spine, your abdominal problem will go. He was like this. There are a lot of folds on his abdomen. He's treated by so many gastroenterologists or so many ultrasound scans. All these things were done. And finally, he came to us 4 or 5 years back. And he said, doctor, this is what was told to me. I know I have this problem. And can you help me? I don't want to live this life. Whatever happens, I'm accepting that if you can give me the best chance. We assessed everything and I said, yes, we can do deformity correction. There is a good chance you will get better in terms of your spinal deformity. But we don't know how much you will get better in that abdominal because that is not my forte. I don't know what's happening out there. We took our physician's evaluation, cardiology, everything was all right. We operated him. In next 1.5 to 2 months' time, his 20-25 year abdominal indigestion and all these things, whatever used to happen, is completely gone. Great. Now we have 5 year follow-up of him. So whatever must be happening with this significant, you know, key compressive thing in the intestines and all this, probably they got the natural support. And so these are the miracles, and they are so grateful.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I have personally seen so many patients. Their quality of life is completely different.
Yeah,
after the surgeries.
Yeah, I told the one X-ray I showed, and her this patient wife told doctor, I am so thankful that I am seeing my husband for the first time straight. After the marriage, she never saw him straight, and this is the first time. I am so grateful now. And this man has become a mountain man. He's walking, he's climbing on the mountains, and he's taking a lot of underprivileged kids, poor kids for mountaineering as a social cause. He feels that I should do something. Now I got a new life. So all these are great stories with us, you know, because of this such a dreadful disease.
Thank you. So, panel, do you have any other question for sir? Or sir, do you have any question for us?
No, I thank you all for giving me this opportunity on the prestigious Rheumat TV. And Dr. Nalavade, Dr. Ekbote, and our rising superstar, Dr. Nilesh Patil, for this wonderful opportunity. And my colleague, Dr. Divakar, also for giving his inputs for this. Thank you very much, guys. I have no questions for you.
I think we are done with the questions. Yes. So I would like to conclude the session by this amazing session by thanking Dr. Shailesh for his invaluable insight. And I would like to also thank all the panelists, Ajit Nalavade sir, Gayatri, Dr. Divakar, for their valuable time. And I would like to thank Dr. Ashok Shan sir and Dr. Rahul Chobe sir for their back-end support. And last but not the least, Parag Sanchiti sir and Sanchiti Hospital for giving us this wonderful opportunity. So it was really indeed a wonderful session.
Thank you.